Okay, welcome back. So in this class, we will look at certain problems involving effect of mean stress and also estimating the life in the case when you have mean stress acting on the specimen. Okay, so this is the problem that we are going to solve. So a ductile steel sample has an ultimate tensile strength of 550 MPa. An yield strength of 415 MPa and a corrected endurance limit of 150 MPa. Determine the factor of safety under the following loading conditions, these two loading conditions, using both the Soderberg and modified Goodman lines in each case. So that means two, when you have, if you remember the discussion on the fatigue failure in the presence of mean stress, we have different failure theories. Like as in the case of static failure theories, one of them was Soderberg and another one was Goodman, and there was another one called Gerber's parabola. Right? So here what we are actually plotting is on the y-axis stress amplitude and the x-axis we are plotting mean stress. And if let us say on the x-axis, if you identify, let's say this to be our yield strength Sy, and that to be our ultimate strength SUT. On the y-axis, you have identified your corrected endurance strength SU. Okay. So now what we are actually saying is that this failure lines, suppose if I am joining SE with SUT, that is my Goodman line. And if I am joining my SE with SY, that is my Soderberg line. Maybe I will draw the Soderberg line with a different color just to distinguish these two guys. So let me draw the Soderberg line with the blue color. Okay, so the blue line is the Soderberg line. So the Soderberg line between SE and SY. So this is Soderberg. And the black one is Goodman or modified Goodman. Okay. So these are the failure surfaces. That means if your stress state, any stress state is within this domain. Suppose if you have a stress state, meaning the combination of mean stress and stress amplitude is somewhere here, this is safe because it is within the failure domain. If the stress state is outside that, then it is not safe. This is not safe. And this is safe, both with respect to Goodman and Soderberg. However, if your stress state is somewhere here, then this is safe according to Goodman and unsafe according to Soderberg, right? Because it's outside the Soderberg line. Okay, so now the data that we have is the ultimate strength is 550 MPa and yield strength SY is 415 MPa and endurance limit is 150 MPa. So if you are looking at Soderberg criterion, if you use, then you can write your failure. The line can be represented as sigma m by Sy plus sigma a by Se is equal to 1 by n, where n is your factor of safety. Okay. So now we need to find out what is the factor of safety. That implies n is equal to Sy Se divided by sigma m Se plus sigma a Sy. So we know all these values. That is equal to Sy is 415, Se is 150, sigma m, we don't know what is sigma m, and that's what we need to figure out. So for the state, loading state 1, What is sigma m? So this is 100 plus or minus 90 MPa. So that means 100 is sigma mean is 100 and stress amplitude is 90. Right? For the second problem, sigma mean is 385 and stress amplitude is 220. Okay, so we need to first let us look at for the case one. So n a is equal to 415 into 150 by sigma m is 100 and se is 150 plus sigma a is 90, sy is 450. So what would that value be? Let me calculate. That is 450 times 150 divided by 100 into 150 plus 90 into 450. So that comes out to be 1.189. That is the factor of safety according to Soderberg. Okay, so the same thing, if we have to do the factor of safety. So now if you look at Goodman, so let's also calculate factor of safety according to Soderberg at point B. That will be the numerator will not change because that is material property. And now sigma m is 385 into 150 plus sigma a is 20 into 415. That would be, let me calculate once again, 415 into 150 divided by 385 into 150 plus 20 into 450. So that is basically coming out to be 0.942. Pay attention. This is less than 1. That means it is not safe. That means the material, according to Soderberg criterion, the second stress state corresponds to failure of it. It would have failed because it is going out of the Soderberg line because it's less than 1. Okay. So now let us look at Goodman. What is Goodman criterion? Sigma m by SUT plus sigma a by SE is equal to 1 by n. Okay, that is the representation of the boundary. So therefore, I will say NG because Goodman. Therefore, NG is equal to SE SUT divided by sigma m SE plus sigma a times SUT. So according to Goodman criterion, the factor of safety for stress loading state A, for load state A, SE and SUT will not change, whether it is loading A or B, 150 times SUT is 550 divided by sigma m for stress state A is 100 into 150 plus sigma m, and sigma a is 90 into 550. All right, so let me calculate that again. 150 into 550 divided by 100 into 150 plus 90 into 550. So that comes out to be 1.27 or 279, that is 1.28. So the factor of safety for the stress state A is 1.28. Let us see what is the factor of safety at stress state B. That is 150 into 550 divided by sigma m in the second case is 385 into 150 plus 20 into 550. Right? So let me do that calculation once again. That comes out to be 1.2. So now let us compare. So stress state A and stress state B and factor of safety according to Soderberg and factor of safety according to Goodman. So at stress state at point A, according to Soderberg, is 1.189 and B 0.94. and this is 1.28 and 1.2. So if you carefully look at these things, loading A and loading B, you can see that the factors of safety according to Soderbergh criterion are always lower than the Goodman criterion. And you will see that this guy, according to Soderbergh criterion, you would have said that the material has failed, but actually it did not according to Goodman criterion. And we know that Goodman criterion is a better criterion for fatigue failure, because the fracture actually means the ultimate strength, not really the fatigue, the yield strength. So that's why the experimental results show a better match with the Goodman diagram compared to Soderbergh diagram. So according to Goodman, both the loading scenarios are safe, although the factors of safety are not really high. So it's a 1.28 or 1.3, 1.2. So the factors of safety are very not really very high values. Okay, so that's how we can actually calculate the factor of safety for a given scenario. All right, let us look at another problem. So how do we go about calculating the life in the presence of mean stress? Okay, here we will look at again three different stress states, and then we will make a comparison in the end. So what we are actually having here is that you have a component that is made of steel, whose tensile strength is 555 MPa, and a corrected endurance strength, or SE, is 250 MPa, subjected to bending loads. Okay. For each of the following loads, so these scenarios, the life of the component, assuming high cycle fatigue, and that infinite life is reached at 10 power 6 cycles. So you have a scenario wherein you know what is the endurance strength of the material, that is 250, SUT is 555 MPa. This is for repeated fully reversed loading, bending loads. Now, not necessarily fully reversed loading, they didn't say anything. SE is what they have found out for 250 MPa. At that, you will get 10 power 6 cycles life. All right. Now, for each of these loading scenarios, what is the life of the component? That is what we need to figure out. Okay, so if you take the case A, sigma m is 277.5 MPa and sigma A is 85 MPa. Okay, and now let us see the scenario of Goodman diagram. That is your sigma A, sigma M, and here you will have SUT. So according to Goodman diagram, so since we are not given any criterion, so we are using Goodman because we know that that is a better criterion. Sigma M by our SUT, sigma A by SE equal to 1. We are not considering any factor of safety. If you consider any factor of safety, you can assume a factor of safety, whatever. Then 1 by that factor of safety. Here I am assuming factor of safety to be 1. So and hence I am not really taking that factor of safety into account. Okay. So now, corresponding to this stress state, what is my SE I need to calculate? So that means this stress state, what is my SE? SE equal to sigma A divided by 1 minus sigma M by SUT. So SE A, sigma A, sigma M A. A means load state A. That is equal to, that is 85 divided by 1 minus 277.5 divided by 555. If you do that, then you will get 170 MPa. Because 1/2 and so 2 goes into the numerator, then you get 170 MPa. That is your SE, correct? Similarly, if you take a stress state B, you can actually calculate sigma A at 1 minus sigma MB by SUT. and again plug in. Here in this case, sigma a is 207.8 divided by 1 minus 200 by 555. So that comes out to be about 324 MPa. Similarly, SEC, again, sigma AC divided by 1 minus sigma MC by SUT, that is equal to, here 236 is the stress amplitude, 111 is the mean stress, so that is 236 divided by 1 minus 111 by 555. So that comes out to be 296 MPa. Okay, so we have each of these stress states, we have calculated what is our SA, so endurance limit, so that is SEA is equal to, for corresponding to stress state A, it is 170. Stress state B, you have 324. Stress state C, 295. So rather than calling this SE, I could actually calculate the failure strength, because if I am talking about, this is my SUT, normally this is my stress state, right? So what is my sigma M? So SUT is your 555, sigma M is 277.5, that is halfway, somewhere here, and 85, so let us say this is the point, that is the failure point, right? So then what you need to do is, you need to join these lines, and then this is the value that I am for. This corresponds to a particular number of cycles, NF here. Similarly, if I say my SA, sigma M is 200, that is somewhere here, sigma A is, sigma M is 200, sigma A is something here, that is, let us say, point B, 207.8, then my failure line would be that. So that will be my SEB, SEA. And similarly for SEC. Right? So SEC will be somewhere in between, because this is 170 and this is 324. And SEC will be somewhere in between 296. Because if you would plot the, that would have been your SEC. The point would have been somewhere in between. Okay. So corresponding to these stress amplitudes, what is the life norm for each of these materials, loading states? So again, because it's a material given to be steel, or it's given to be component is made of steel, as we can see. So this is made of steel. And hence, we can say that we can construct the SN diagram by knowing SM is equal to 0.9 SUT. That would be what? 555 into 0.9, that is 499.5 MPa. And SE is given as 250 MPa, right? For that particular scenario. So now, this is for 10 power 6 cycles, right? So here 499.5 10 cube cycles, and here and then you may have, this is your 250 MPa and 250 MPa and 10 power 6 cycles, that's what we have, right? Now you need to find out the material property A and B, because this is for a particular loading scenario. This is what your A and B, but A and B values themselves will not change depending upon the loading scenario, because A and B are your material properties, correct? So you just find out A and B from this data. So what is your B? B is equal to log SM by SE divided by log NM by NE, that is equal to log 499.5 divided by 250 divided by log 10 cube by 10 power 6. Okay, so doing that, you will get B to be minus 0.1. and A comes out to be Sm by Nm power B, that is 499.5 divided by 10 power minus 0.3, that is equal to 996.63. Therefore, your S can be written as 996.63 N power minus 0.1. That is your stress life relation for the system. Now, corresponding to, now what we have done, corresponding to this particular loading scenario, what we have written was our failure happens at 170 MPa. Okay, if the failure is happening at 170 MPa, then what is the number of cycles? So what we need to find out, Na, number of cycles to failure, is equal to Sa divided by 996.63 whole to the power minus 1 by 0.1, right? Sa, you plug that in, is to be 170, then that comes out to be, so what would that be? Sa, if you plug that to be 170, let us see what happens. 170 divided by 996.63 to the power minus 10, right? 1 by minus 0.1 is minus 10 to the power minus 10. So that turns out to be 4,795,6,816 cycles. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. That means it is greater than 10 power 6 cycles and hence infinite life for the first scenario. And let us look at the second scenario, that is NFB turns out to be 75,838 cycles. That is corresponding to 324 SE. NFB corresponding to 324 SE. NFC corresponding to 295 MPa is coming out to be 196,395 cycles. So what basically this is telling you is that out of these three stress states, the first stress state gives you infinite life. Second stress state gives you a life of 75,800 cycles. Third stress state gives you a little bit more, 196,395 cycles. So what we have done here is that you have a combined state of loading. That means you have a mean stress effect. In the presence of mean stress, how do we go about finding the life of the component? So the SN behavior, the stress life behavior, is governed by the material property. So that stress life behavior is governed by the material property, which is described by your equation S is equal to A n power b, right? This is described by the relation S is equal to A n power b, and A and b are your material constants depending on which points you are connecting. Okay, so all that you need to check is that from the mean stress and stress amplitude information, you calculate what is your SE corresponding to, that means failure corresponding to this guy, and then you will be able to calculate the life of the component at for different scenarios. Okay, so now let us look at so that's about how do we go about dealing with the effect of mean stress. Let's look at one last problem for today's discussion, is that it is basically the crack growth rate depending on the Paris law. This similar problem we have probably solved during the regular lectures also, but I am trying to reiterate again here. Okay, so a component in the shape of a large sheet is fabricated from aluminum, which has a fracture toughness of 24.2 MPa root meter and a tensile yield strength of 500 MPa. Okay, so it has a tensile yield strength of 500 MPa. Determine the number of loading cycles that can be endured if the nominal stress varies from 100 MPa to one half of the yield strength. So you have a scenario wherein your fracture toughness of the material is given as 24.2 MPa root meter. And this loading is actually, if you see this guy, this is load stress time. Then it is actually cycling from 100 MPa to one half of the yield strength. One half of yield strength is about 250, right? This is 250. So basically it is cycling between, this is the loading scenario. I have chosen it to be sinusoidal, but it doesn't have to be. But what is important here is your sigma max is 250 MPa and sigma min is 200 MPa. That's what we are saying. And we are required to determine the number of cycles that can be endured when the stress cycles between 0 and 100 and 250. If the initial crack length is 6.6 mm. So you have an edge crack in the specimen. So let us say you have this specimen, in that you have an edge crack whose length is 0.6 mm, which is subjected to some sort of a bending load or which is continuously loaded between 100 and 250 mm. Then how much is the life that is left until it actually becomes a critical crack and then the specimen breaks? So this is something that we have discussed extensively, that even if you have some crack to begin with, you may still be able to use the specimen. That is precisely what we are trying to address to this problem. How many cycles can I use? How many cycles of this loading can be applied on this specimen before it actually fractures? Of course, we are assuming that everything is linear elastic. So everything is in the elastic fracture mechanics. There is no plasticity whatsoever. Okay. So your initial crack length is 0.6 mm, or that is equal to 0.6 into 10 power minus 3 meters. Everything I am keeping in meters so as to keep things consistent in terms of units. So the final crack length, what would be the crack length at which it actually fails? So the final crack length is, or the crack length, critical crack length at which it fails, is actually, you can say that that is equal to, that can be found by knowing the relation, fracture toughness is sigma critical root pi a. Okay. Or you can, if you have some sigma, so and this will be a critical. That is how. So when this crack length becomes, if the length of the crack becomes AC, that is when, for a given sigma, if that becomes equal to fracture toughness, that is when the system collapses, right? So here in this system, you have maximum stress that the material is experiencing is 250 MPa. So you can actually write this as sigma max. That implies AC is equal to KC by sigma max root pi whole square, right? So that actually turns out to be, if you plug that in, that is equal to 1 by pi, say KC is 24.2 MPa root meter divided by sigma max is 250 MPa whole square. And that turns out to be 2.98 mm. Okay. So it actually comes out to be 2.98 into 10 power minus 3 meters, because everything is in meters. So it comes out to be eventually 2.98 mm. Okay. So that is our critical crack. So that means initially you have 0.6 mm, but when this 0.6 mm crack length becomes 2.98 mm, that is when the failure happens. That means you can actually apply this loading until those many number of cycles where the crack length 0.6 becomes 2.98, because the crack is gradually growing, right? From 0.6 to 2.98, it can grow. Until then, the structure is safe. The moment it becomes 2.98, that is when the failure happens. Okay. So how do we calculate this? So we know that crack growth rate by Paris law is given by dA by dN is equal to, in the class we have used C delta K power M. Here in this problem, this A is like C and M is like N. So you can actually write that as A delta K power M. Okay. So what is my delta K? Delta K is equal to delta sigma root pi A. What is delta sigma? That is 250 minus 100, that is stress range, root pi, that is 150 root pi. That is what is your delta k. So let me write down the Paris law. dA by dN is equal to C or A, whatever it, what here we have, since A is given as A delta k power m. Right, m is equal to 4. So now I can do some rearrangement of this equation, and then I can write. So this can be written as, that implies dA by dN is equal to A sigma power m, sorry, delta sigma power m root pi A to the power m, right? The delta sigma root pi A whole power m. So delta sigma, I'm taking it out, root pi, and A is the variable because you are differentiating with respect to A. So I can write dA by root A or dA by a power m by 2 integral initial crack length to the critical crack length is equal to dN integral 0 to number of cycles to failure times, this can be, because the dN can come this side, so this becomes a, one minute. Let me rewrite this guy because we need to find out the life. So I am writing dN integral 0 to number of cycles to failure is equal to integral initial crack length to the critical crack length times dA divided by C or A delta sigma power m pi power m by 2 times a power m by 2. That's what we have. And we have in this problem, we have m is equal to 4 and delta sigma is equal to 150 and a is equal to 5 into 10 power minus 11 in the consistent units. Therefore, nf is equal to 1 over 5 into 10 power minus 11 into 250 power 4 into pi square. This is a power m by 2 becomes a 4 by 2, so a square. So that means this becomes integral dA by a square ai to af. So that is equal to minus 1 by 5 into 10 power minus 11 into 250 power 4 into pi square. 1 by, so this is 1 by AF minus 1 by AI, AC not being consistent. So what was our AC? What is the length of the crack at which it actually fractures? That is 2.98. So this, whatever this factor, I'm calling this factor to be beta. So minus beta times 1 by 2.98 minus 1 by 0.6. So you can calculate this beta value and then you find out this value will be 5,328 cycles. So that means even if you have an initial crack of length 0.6 mm, you will still be able to retain the functionality until the cycle number of cycles are about 5,328 cycles. Until then, the specimen will be safe. Okay. So with that, I will stop here. And in the next class, we will look at how the petty problems to be solved in the presence of notches.